I guess we should go ahead and get it cranked up here. I guess this is supposed to be a chat between me and Michael. I've got a couple of things I've pulled up that I maybe want to ask him about. It'd be fairly free-ranging. What do you think? You think we kind of just exchange a little bit, and if there's questions from the audience, we let them just kind of come in and just keep it casual?
Yes. I wanted to ask you first to describe what got you into doing what you do.
This is science fiction fantasy via comic books, I guess, is where I kind of came from as a kid. I think I came more from science fiction film and TV. I'm the generation where Star Wars is my 7-8-year-old, gosh, wow, you know, this is what I want to be doing the rest of my life kind of experience. So I'm born in 69, so in the mid-70s, that's when I'm in elementary school and middle school. And comics and science fiction film are the things that are sort of my touchstones with the field, not so much the literature at that point. I was a voracious reader, but I really wasn't hitting like all the heavies as much as I wish I would at that point. That didn't come till later, and I came to the field via sort of a roundabout way. Architecture school graduate, University of Texas. Went to work in architecture, but all the while through school and into my first few years of architecture, I was doing comic books on my own.
Did you know such things as science fiction or fantasy or comic book conventions even existed?
Comic book conventions, yeah, San Diego Comic Con, but the Fanish literary scene, I did not. And so I'm gonna just kind of tie this up in a few sentences here, because it's kind of a long route, but I don't think you need to hear it all. I'm doing my own comic books, self-publishing. Happy just to kind of be doing my own comics while I'm working during the day, 8 to 10 hours doing architecture. And these book publishers started noticing my comics and said, hey, have you ever thought about doing book covers?
Yes.
And here's the honest to gosh answer. I said, no. And they said, would you like to do some? And my first answer was no. And I said, because I really like doing my comics. You know? And I thought, I don't have much time because of the architecture day job, so I'm going to keep doing this. And they said, no, really, you should do it. We've got a book by a guy named Michael Moorcock, and it's called Behold a Man. And why don't you give it a try? And I read it, and that book, 1996, Michael Moorcock's 30th anniversary edition from Mojo Press. I don't want to make it too dramatic, but that really changed everything. Not only the job, but the book itself, you know, really hit me. If I would have read that as a teenager, that really just lost my world in any more profound way.
Did you feel like it opened up a world of possibilities to you to have gone through that process?
I think the architecture was great because it gave me a grounding in process and design and problem solving, really. You know, where I felt the confidence of being able to look at any situation and be able to think it through as a problem solving thing, as opposed to just looking at things as... I've always wished I would have gone to art school formally, honestly. But I sort of feel maybe it worked out well to go to architecture school and come in maybe with less, how to say this, inhibitions, maybe feeling a little more confident about my problem solving, just looking at things in a more open way.
I think that's likely to be true. When I graduated from San Jose State University, I went to Art Center for a while because I felt it's something that I had to do to be a professional illustrator. And I only lasted there for 9 months because I quickly became aware that what it was in the process of doing for illustrators was educating the current crop to do whatever the most successful last graduate was doing. So for me it was Mark English, you know, when I was in there. But when Mark English was in, they were trying to get everyone painted for a few or something like that, and it was a sequential thing like that. And when I realized that Mark English and, you know, most of the artists that I respected who were working as illustrators at the time had all dropped out of Art Center. And, you know, I realized that there's a message in that somewhere. So I did too.
Yeah. You know, I felt like at that time that I knew I was good at architecture and I was making really good money. And of course my self-published stuff wasn't making money, but I was happy to win it. And then when I got that book job with Michael Moorcock, I was not only doing the cover, which is a horrible cover, by the way, that was my first one, and then did, but I got to do these ink interiors for it. that were very evocative of my comic book. I should use this.
The ink interiors were very evocative of my comic book work at the time. But just getting to sort of look at that whole book as an object and think through not just what my work was doing. They actually let me typeset the book too. They let me do the whole thing. But getting to sort of look at the book not only just as a cover job, but just thinking of it as a whole object. I guess not unlike the way I was thinking of houses at the time. You know, I'm not just thinking of one aspect of the house. I'm thinking of the site, you know, where the wind goes, where the views are, how the sun hits it. So looking at the book as a whole, I fell in love, man. I mean, I really did. That was it. And then from that point on, seriously, the days were numbered in architecture. So to hit your point about the convention scene and being aware of it, I totally wasn't. There was an editor named Rick Claw who in 2000 said, look, you've got a portfolio here. I've got my first job at Del Rey at that point. And he said, World Fantasy's coming to Corpus Christi. I live in San Antonio, Texas. It's about 3 hours, less than that actually, from San Antonio. World Fantasy 2000, he says, about a month before the show, look, I know you don't have much money, but you really need to just figure out a way to get down there. All
have you ever found points of tangency between doing architectural work and work as an illustrator? Have you ever tried to bring what you did in that into interior illustration work?
I think the way I mean, again, it goes back to problem solving. And so in that way, I feel like the architectural experience helped me. I think the architectural experience helped me in terms of business and how you deal with clients better than it did as far as visuals. I don't think there's much connection between how I thought as an architect and how I do things as an illustrator. It helped with the business, though. And I think I was a lot more advanced than some of my peers. I would say people who were my age. And I came into this late, so I mean, 96, well, I don't go full-time until 01. And so it's shortly after that World Fantasy experience that I ditched architecture. So I've been at this full-time now since April 26, 2001.
You know Daniel Martin's work?
Yeah, I love his work.
Yeah, well, he was trained as an architect then. He brings his knowledge of architecture into a lot.
I can totally see architecture
see
and stuff. Yeah.
He takes it and extrapolates.
You know, absolutely.
His paintings become fantasy constructs, but a lot of it is obviously based on his architectural knowledge.
Yeah, I don't see a connection, you know, with there's not a whole lot of architecture in my work now that I think of it, really. Again, it comes back to problem solving. There are a number of illustrators, and I think that come from that background.
Dave Seeley.
Dave Seeley's another one, yeah, who has that. So once I came to World Fantasy in 2000, then I started to very quickly become aware of the regional SF shows and, of course, Worldcon, and the fact that World Fantasy was where I meet Irene Gallo at Tor, and I started meeting other authors and friends, and that changed my world. Honestly, yeah. It shifted at that point from a world of hoping to be in the business to all of a sudden, I still had friends who were not in this field, but they were very quickly going other directions, and I found myself, my whole life revolved around the people at these conventions, the professionals that were at my same age and level trying to go forward. When did you sort of connect with this thing? How did that work for you? I mean, San Jose, you're talking early 70s,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then, so what's the...
Well, I was at Art Center and I saw a sheet on a bulletin board advertising San Diego Comic-Con.
Okay.
And I said, Comic-Con? And I saw that their guest list was amazing. It said Charles Schulz, Jack Kirby, Ray Bradbury. And I thought, you mean you can go to a place and actually talk to these people or have access to them? It just seemed fantasy to me. But for some reason, I felt it would be worth making a 2-hour drive down to San Diego and at least putting some work in the art show and see what happened. And
did they have an art show? They actually have an art show that people...
Okay. I mean, it was nothing, it's nowhere near the scale it's at. This is 1974 we're talking about, so they must have 1,000 people there or something.
Okay, okay.
And I couldn't afford to stay in a hotel, so I didn't stay down there. And, you know, I talked to some people and saw some authors from a distance, but I didn't got the nerve to talk to anybody, but I sold what I had in the art show and met somebody who was going to the World Science Fiction Convention that fall.
Okay.
And one thing led to another, you know, but it all started with going to the San Diego Comic-Con.
Really? So. And so when you came to World Science Fiction Convention, what year is that? Which city is that one? Do you remember?
That was in Washington, D.C. I didn't go, but okay. Somebody I met at San Diego Comic-Con was going there and offered to take some of my pieces and put it in the show.
I see.
So I said, well, if you put them in the show, listen as professional work, not amateur, so I'd see how Oh, it does, the art show.
Right. And what was the reaction? And
well, I got first place for a science fiction in the art show. So I said, well, that gave me the nerve to submit my work, to send samples of my work to some of the publishers in New York, and I got a positive response from one, so I sold.
And you're in California?
I fit my Volkswagen, drove out to the East Coast.
Okay, so you were in California at this point, so that's...
Yeah.
So you have to drive out to the East Coast, and what publisher?
Pretty much had to. The only one I know who was working outside the East Coast was Don Ivan Hutchatz, and he told me at that time his agent was telling all his publishers that he lived in New Jersey, and they didn't know any better, you know, for a while that he was living in Texas. So,
literally, if you weren't living in that in the upper East Coast,
in the tri-state area,
you weren't
New Jersey, Connecticut, New York, it was very hard to get work. Yeah.
Just because they needed those face-to-face relationships to feel better about trusting
well,
you to take on a job?
The shipping services weren't that like they are now. You didn't have overnight delivery except for things like blood samples. Organs, you know. If you labeled your painting as a kidney or something, that all changed. I used a courier service for a long time because I wanted to go from my hands to the hands of whoever the art director was. And be, you know, it was worth the thing at the time. $75 to have somebody drive it into the city and actually hand it to the person I wanted to go to. But it saved me a day's worth of work. I didn't have to go into the city and lose time traveling.
Right. I just want to pause a little further. But so you go to the East Coast, I mean, you literally just, you're not saying you take all your possessions and you move. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. And this is before?
I banked it all on one letter from Donald Wilhines.
So this is Dog.
Yeah.
Dog. Okay.
I didn't have any doubt that it was going to be worth that I would make. I figure I'll work as hard as I have to work to make a living, and so I'm just going to make it happen. So
you're a single man at this point?
Or yeah. Well, actually, no. It was in my first marriage.
Okay. Got it. So you go down there, and how does that go? I mean, how you go straight to their office and show a portfolio, and you're given a gig, and
I had assignments already lined up with Dog Books. The funny thing was, having worked at the Rollcon, it was seen by an agent from Germany, and he expressed interest in my work before anybody else did, and so I was selling foreign rights to my work before I got my first assignment here.
That's interesting.
So all the pieces of my portfolio were being published in Germany and Italy and places like that already before I started getting hired in the U.S. So when I came to New York, I heard about Lunacon.
Okay.
So I came in, I started working in October, and Lunacon was in January, I think, and I said, well, I'll take some pieces I got laying around here. And I went to Lunacon, put some pieces up in the art show, and Harlan Ellison was there.
Oh, okay.
And he said, he bought a piece, and he told me he really liked my work and would like to have me do an illustration for a story. So he got me my first magazine.
Okay.
So, but see, again, you know, if it wasn't there in the convention, it wouldn't
happen. Exactly. And that's the magic of these things, really. I think you just kind of have to be open. The more open you are,
you get around.
Yeah.
And let opportunities happen. They're not going to happen if you're alone in your studio. You've got to get out.
Or hanging out with
meet it halfway, anyway.
That's right. Or hanging out with one crowd. I learned that pretty quick because I started to sort of stay in one circle, and I realized, not so much that it wasn't getting me anywhere, but more just it would be accidents of people that I would have thought, we have no connection. Mm-hmm. And those ended up becoming the most valuable. Not only allies professionally, but personally, people that would help you grow. It was the people who weren't doing art, people who were doing words or editing or even copy editing, who would make me look at things in a different way and shift my view, you know?
Yeah.
While the artists were a lot of my core friends, still my best friend is Lou Anders, an editorial director, who now all of a sudden become an art director because we stayed friends.
Yeah.
Anyway, okay, so I'll just follow this a little further than you don't mind. So is the reaction to your work as far, I guess at that point, because that's mid-70s, obviously long before internet, do you have fan reaction to your stuff at this point? When do you start to realize that your stuff is really becoming a touchstone for...
It's when I went to, not I just my first, when I actually went to my first WorldCon, and there was one in 76 in Kansas City, and I said, well, it's a big chance, but I decided to put things in the frames and actually drive up there to Kansas City. So Audrey and I drove out, and I put a whole bunch of stuff in the art show, and this was a major art show. I mean, Kelly Freese was a big presence there, and there were so many great artists in this show. I was dismayed. I walked out of there saying, you know, I don't know how we're going to get home. The last day, you know, late on Sunday, we had $25.
Because of framing and shipping?
Yeah.
Framing and shipping and all that?
And I thought something, at least we'll get a bid on in the art show. Nothing had a bid on it. And then it was like something in a movie. All of a sudden, everyone, you know, there was a last minute buying spree, and people came in and bought everything.
Wow.
You know?
Wow.
And so, awesome. And I had people fighting over access to pieces and stuff like that. And at that point, I said, wow, this is, you know, I just couldn't believe it.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, but yeah. Gave you confidence?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Can I say something? I mean, I'm just a fan, but Mid-AmeriCon was my first Worldcon, and I've been reading SF since the early 70s. And I have to say, the first artist who really impressed me was you. And I was at that art show, and I thought, this guy is unbelievable. And I'm frankly stunned to hear, as you just said, that you really started in like 73, 74. Because I thought you'd kind of...
Yeah, 74.
I mean, and then you and Daryl Sweet and Carl Lundgren, I mean, you guys were the great guys from the late 70s to the 80s. And I just loved your work. So anyway.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
I made up my mind when I was that I wouldn't show my work until I felt it was at least as good as some of the work already on the stands.
Right.
You know, and the chief defect I see in student work, I see a lot of student portfolios. I think all of us do go to conventions and make ourselves accessible to people who are trying to get work in the field, is that they don't have a sense of how their work stacks up to what's already being done.
Yeah.
They have either an inflated sense or they have a sense that their work's not as good as it is. But either way, they err quite a bit on one side or the other. And having a somewhat accurate sense of that is extremely valuable because it aids you in pricing. But it also, I think it's very injurious when you're trying to start out to show your work before you're ready to. And because the art directors, if they remember you at all, are going to remember how bad your work was.
Sure.
And even if you've improved a little bit, when you go back and see them again, you've damaged yourself.
Yeah.
And so it's,
how do you
it's
know?
Better to wait a little bit.
How do you, what are some touchstones or signposts do you think that kind of let you know? I mean, you just have to have that sense, develop a sense of objective judgment.
Well, we're lucky we have the science fiction convention. You know, if you show your work in shows and you win a bunch of ribbons and stuff, that's an indication.
Yeah.
You know, that it's got some popular appeal because people are voting on it as the best piece in the show or one of the best pieces. So that's an indicator there.
But I think these
a
days
lot of people have so little sense that they've got to rely on an agent to tell them.
Right.
And that's a slippery slope.
Agents. So that was somewhere I was going to go at some point.
Have you ever been agented? I've never heard of you having an agent.
No?
No, but I heard about people who had agents. And guys like Don Mates, you know, were given 25% of what they made to this guy to be on his list. And I figured I've got to, you know, I can make my own mistakes, and no matter how bad my mistakes are, they're surely not going to cost me more than 25% of my life. And when I stop making the mistakes, it's all going to be mine.
Right.
You know, so I thought, and I'd rather learn the business lessons and acquire them myself than have somebody else do it.
Well, the way I looked at it too was I said, you know, I would, when I first got started, I thought, well, there's going to be a point where my work may be deemed worthy enough to where perhaps agents would want to work with me, but you know, that was something where I thought, well, eventually I'll get that to that point, but I'm not ready for it yet, obviously, because nobody's done it. And there came to be a point where I thought, well, maybe I need to pursue this. So
yeah.
I literally asked some art directors. I think I asked Irene at one point, you know, who are some of the major agents, and is there, you know, how should I approach this? And I realized pretty quick that right around that point, I realized, wait a minute, part of what was working for me is I had gone to several of these conventions and started making a yearly routine, trying to move around the country. Where these relationships were probably the things that were going to get me through the dark times, you know? And so to sit there and then just stay at home and let the agent kind of handle all those things, I might be losing one of my strengths, which
is exactly,
having that
yeah.
face-to-face contact.
Yeah,
right?
And you're deliberately leaving yourself in ignorance.
That's right.
That can't help.
Yeah, so I tell people when they're asking me about agents, you know, there's nothing, I have nothing truly bad to say because I haven't had any bad experience, but I never had one. But I would just say, I always tell them to make sure you nurture those face-to-face relationships yourself. If you do get an agent, don't let that stuff go. Make sure you still stay physically, you know, in touch with people.
Yeah, there's no, no pat answer to that question because, excuse me, their personalities are different. Some people don't have a personality that, I've got some here, I'll just, but that prevents them from being able to deal with business things. And if you know you have that as a limitation and you don't feel you can overcome it, then you're better off having an agent. I know the world of Hollywood and the music business are like, it's like talking to people on Mars. And if you can't be in Hollywood and do deals and talk to people directly, it's better to have an agent. So in Hollywood, I have an agent, and in Europe, I have an agent. Because I want a set of eyes over in Europe, a guy who's got a financial interest in me being ripped off. So if he sees somebody who's publishing something that he didn't license, and he's got all my licensing there, then he knows he's losing money. So here, I've got an active agent who's going after people trying to either plagiarize my work or use it without my permission. So for him, it's worth losing 20% because I'm saving myself from the Czechoslovakian publishers that are ripping everybody else off, you know, because he'll go there and send him a letter, send Stefan with a baseball bat and say, and, you know, that's worth, you know, a percentage, you know. So you have to weigh the cost benefit ratio. I can't be in Japan, so it would pay me to have somebody in Japan representing my interests because I can't physically be there on a regular basis and manage things. So.
I didn't come around to be part of the scene until about, like I said, 2000, late 2000. So I missed a lot of the prime glory years for you in the field. But were you a regular convention goer, like say between 80 to 2000, I'll just throw it out. I mean, were you fairly regular at these shows?
There's some years where I went to three conventions in a year. But, I tried to always get to the Worldcons. But and maybe I'd make one or two regionals besides that. But it depended a lot on the kids' school schedules and stuff like that. You know? So, no, I didn't go I think the most we went to in 1 year is probably five.
Okay.
In the mid-80s. But we went to a Gen Con. And my son came down with some kind of disease that put spots all over him. And it was over a weekend on a Sunday, on a holiday weekend, and there were no doctors to be found anywhere. And it was such a nightmare. I said, you know what? I don't want to do this again like this. You know, so we either hire a babysitter to come with us or, you know, whatever. So we found other arrangements. But yeah. Things like that would limit how many conventions we'd go to. It's because you lose a lot of time as an artist just getting ready for this convention.
Absolutely.
You know, I spent 2.5 days taking out work, dusting it off, and creating it. And you know, it's a lot of time lost.
It is.
Time I don't have.
Yeah.
You know, so
I don't know how many times Tracy got tired of hearing me say, authors don't have to go through this.
Yeah.
Authors work. I think what I kept saying is work guys. They don't have to go through this.
Yeah.
Anyways, wham.
Yeah. I'm complaining because I want to look at America.
It's good to be one and it's good to be here. So just jumping back, you're going through several conventions a year. You don't have an agent, but the word just kind of is, how are you getting, is the word just getting out about you? Just keeps getting out and great cover, just keeps building the word?
The best thing you can do is do the best work you can do.
Yeah, but did you have self-promotional things that you were doing? Was Audrey kind of working that in?
I haven't had a portfolio in decades.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't have one
and
now.
You didn't do mail outs or things like that?
No.
Okay. I was just curious. It's kind of a trivial question.
Yeah, the best way to build your business is to be on books that get on the bestseller list, you know? And because it happens time and time again, I'll get a call from a publisher I haven't worked with before, and they're calling me because they saw my cover on a book that was selling well by another company. Somebody higher up than them said, get this guy. We got this book's gonna do better, or do well, you know, so.
I would agree with that. I would say in these days of social media, I think being on bestsellers, you can never argue with that. But I think also being on books that people talk about. Sometimes as an artist, you don't really know going in if this is gonna be something someone's gonna talk about, but you find usually those become extremely valuable to your career.
Or an author that's a rabid fan following.
Or who talks a lot.
Yeah. No, you know, it's a double-edged thing. If you blow it, then there's going to be a lot of bad things being said about you, you know, that can damage you. But if you got passion for what you do, you do. You read the books, you care about what you're illustrating, it shows in your work evokes the books that you do work for. And
you read everything too, didn't you?
Yeah.
You should. You can see it in Snow Queen and those things. But you're pretty much able to keep a schedule where you're able to read most of it. Audrey sometimes have to read?
No. Not work that way. Yeah. I tried hiring someone to be a reader for a book cover I did in 96, and it just didn't work out.
I'm working on this George R. R. Martin calendar right now. And these are gigantic. These Song of Ice and Fire books are gigantic. And I'm on a pretty tight timeline for this stuff. And I knew that although I have some other jobs I'm juggling, I'm going to really be obsessive about this, and it's going to get disgusting for my wife. So I told her, look, for the sake of us, do me a favor. I know you're not huge on epic fantasy. She's more of a horror girl, historical fiction, that kind of thing. But this is epic fantasy. It's not your bag. But please, for the sake of our marriage, at least read the first one, just so when I'm talking about this stuff, you're just not going to
call it
one
anymore.
Well, that's great. It's great. Now she's reading the third one. She's told me about it. Literally, I get to show her the stuff, and she's become a really valuable ally. So.
Being enthusiastic about what you're illustrating makes such a difference.
It's everything. That's
everything. For every night where you're working till 2 in the morning,
I can't do it.
The piece I'm working on now is for a huge book. It's 1,400 pages long. And when I first got it, I groaned. You know, but 10 pages into the book, I was hooked. And I loved it.
Yeah.
I loved it. I'm having such a good time. I told my kids when they were young that success is when you wake up in the morning, you look forward to going to work. That's what you want to do all day. And you know, when I'm in a groove and that's happening, you know, on a daily basis, I think, man, I can't wait. Now I get to do the armor today or whatever. It's, you know, man, you can't put a price on that. And I'm not making a living at it.
Yeah, exactly. Right. I'll say this: that thing that you just said about you're loving the book. Like, I'm loving these George R. R. Martin books. Absolutely, just. I mean, they're dark as hell, and I'm just really enjoying the hell out of this stuff and honored to be part of this. But I'll just say this, that I get this question every once in a while, and I think it still holds true, the answer. But the question is do you have to love the book in order to do a great cover for it? And I personally don't think you have to love the book. But the way I started, I've had to look at it is there's going to be books, and there have been plenty of books, where I didn't love the book. But I can always look at the book. And this goes back to that architectural problem solving, where I look at it almost like a house, where I've got a job, and this site may not be the best site in the world, the views may not be the best, but there's always something good about that project, a good intention or a good, there's always some good that can come out of it. It's my job as a professional to put this thing in the best position to succeed, whether it's a house or whether it's a cover. So I look at a book and say, okay, this is what I think the author's trying to do, even if I don't think it's successful. I'm going to try to evoke that aspect on the cover. So
you're defining what it is to be a professional. That's a professional attitude. You know, you find
but I have
the
to
handle
love
or hook that's going to bring your success.
I'm trying to find a way, an avenue for me to be in love, but even though it's not about totality.
Well, a lot of times it can be from the art standpoint. Your standpoint is it's an art project, you know, so. If I didn't like the book, I'll try to divorce myself in the narrative and think of it as if I'm doing a painting for the gallery or something. It's still a painting problem that has to be solved. You know, so once you work out how the painting is connected to the book so that you're evoking enough of what you're trying to illustrate, the rest of it becomes an academic artistic exercise. And that will be your point of entry into enthusiasm. I have to say that sometimes being over-enthusiastic about something can damage. You know, I've done paintings, bad illustrations for excellent books because I was too enthusiastic and I overthought it, or I tightened up and got an artistic equivalent of stage fright or something working on the painting, and I didn't let myself go and do the kind of job I could have done, and I did a substandard cover and you know, regret it. So this sword cuts both ways.
Have either of you ever had a book you just couldn't get through? Because have you ever picked up a book you've been asked to paint a cover for that you couldn't tolerate reading and couldn't manage to plow through?
You have?
Yeah.
You start on my
book. It's one thing not to like a book because of the style that it's written in, but there have been a couple of times when I've been given assignments for things that I had a moral objection to. There's a book that I was asked to do a cover for that casts a positive light on father-daughter incest, and I said, I'm not doing it. So I'll turn down something that I have an objection to on a level like that. But there have been other books that I've done. I got Lyme disease in the mid-90s, and we went down to Florida while I was recuperating from that, and I had a manuscript from an author who I've done a lot of good work with. And you know, I started to read it, and I just would fall asleep, you know, after the first 50 pages. I couldn't get through the damn book. I couldn't stay awake, no matter how many cups of coffee I had or whatever. Eventually, I struggled through it, but it really impacted the quality of work I did in my cover, because I wasn't hitting on all cylinders, but also the book of her books, it was not one that interested me as much as her other works. The characterizations weren't as compelling, and I, you know, I regret having been assigned that cover, because I don't think I did it justice. I think somebody who the book spoke to better would have done a better job on it. So, it's hard to predict in advance when that's going to happen.
Yeah, that last part I would totally agree with that. There have been a couple of books for me, two that I can think of right now that. Where I literally couldn't finish it just because I couldn't connect on any level with this whole world, the world that this author was building. And it was a very complicated set of, it was names with a lot of apostrophes. Where it's just like, there's no way I can even try to pronounce that if I try to put it off my tongue, much less be reading these page after page after page. And they started intertwining, and names started to look alike. And I literally just kind of had to say, if I keep going, if I keep reading this, I'm going to completely demotivate myself from wanting to do this job. And I literally had to just, there were two books, two different authors, in fact, that were much that same situation, where I stopped reading the book in order to do the job well, or try to salvage doing the job well. And I think in both cases, it was the right, I didn't tell the art directors or the editor or anybody that I didn't read the book. But what I did to get into it was to, actually in one case, I went to the author and asked him some very specific questions about what I had read, and then just kind of, and then the other one, it was pretty close to the deadline, and so I went to the editor, actually, because I knew the editor pretty well for that one, and said, look, you know, I didn't completely tell him the story, but I just said, you know, help me get this job done by speeding my knowledge of this book up a little bit, and that helped me get me through. And in both cases, I think I focused on things that were iconic, which probably helped the book cover connect with a larger audience anyway, so maybe it worked out that way. You know, I wasn't getting so specific.
I've got a question I want to ask you about materials. Does the content of the book that you're responding to dictate your approach? I mean, you've got pieces in the art show that have
kind of all
some
over
are
place.
Painted, some have some digital work, some are a combination of the two, so you've got the thing with the lighted box. And so I was wondering,
I can answer it.
How do you open yourself up to taking different approaches to? And what can you give us any kind of clue as to how the process works in your head?
Yeah.
So I can rip it off.
take it, because I've taken a lot from others, and we just pass it forward. I would say there's a lot in that question. I would say this. I sound like a broken record, but it really does go back to the architecture, where I was looking at projects that were disconnected from each other, and they were always about a certain context that was always different, and I was always looking at what factors impacted those projects, and
yeah.
Not just the client's expectations, but how sun, wind, view, and all that affecting it. And so, when I'm looking at these books, you know, I've got a certain method of traditional digital hybrid work, where I'm doing everything traditionally, doing these elements traditionally, and then often collaging them in Photoshop. I'll talk a little bit more in this demo at 4 o'clock if you're around for that, where I get into that a bit more. But that's the sort of the main method of working, because it's with deadlines being somewhat shorter, maybe than back when you were working the more fully in the field. We can talk about that. I want to talk about the deadline thing too.
Sure.
But it allows me some flexibility there to kind of speed up. Also, kind of keeps me loose, rather than if I was just working on one surface where everything's got to be just right. And if things have revisions on a very tight schedule, I'm going to have a hard time revising this thing
Real
quickly. So it helps me in that way, but yet I still get to get my hands dirty every day and not be locked in front of a computer. But then you see these shadow boxes, like you said, and those are for things where I have a longer deadline, and I think maybe there's more allegory and symbolism's happening. And it's almost like you see an opening where he's like, okay, I think that's one where I can do one of those really special shadow box things, or where I could do something where I'm changing media.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Do you have a sensibility of saying to yourself, I'm gonna liken my own internal leash on myself and let myself have a little more fun with this and go outside some of the borders I've gotten in some of my earlier work? I mean, do you have a sense of that when that process is happening? You have more time to decide to expand into a method of working that you hadn't used before?
It's a good question, because lately I feel like I've been failing on that. I feel like I've been really sort of, I feel like I'm starting this first time in my career in the last year where I think I've overbooked myself a bit. I won't make that mistake this year. I promise you, I'm not going to do that again. I screwed up a little bit.
A lot of artists can't say that they're overbooked.
Well, no, and I don't mean to be sitting here trying to.
No.
Yeah, I didn't mean that in a pompous way. I just, you know, I mean in a bad way. Just really screwed up, you know, because it's made me a bit late on. It's made me late on some things.
Yeah.
You know, one thing, the Elric book that I'm working on, I should have been finished with this thing several months ago, and it's, you know. Yeah, because of being overbooked, I've really stretched it out.
Yeah.
So that's just unconscionable, you know? I really hate that. So I feel like because of when I put myself in those sort of very rough time signatures, I'm suddenly kind of playing riffs that I've played already.
Yeah.
And I've always thought I don't want to be that guy.
Yeah.
You know? And I think that's the downside. Not only that you're unprofessional in terms of being late, but you start to sort of see tropes.
Yeah,
And I think technically I've seen, like, I'm not expanding like I was maybe a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. It's the time for me. That was it. So I think this year, once I kind of get past this tsunami that I built on myself, clear it out a bit, I think hopefully I'll be able to explore a bit more, push. Because I think when I was doing those shadow boxes, sometimes I was cleaning some stuff out, you know, and able to move on. And just to finish it off, with architecture, you couldn't be locked into one material palette. At least I didn't think the good ones ever were. The great architects always were able to look at different materials in a way that was true to their character. And I try to look at stories that way, you know? And so I try to think of what media would help evoke those things. And so I never came into the field with sort of a thing of like, I'm a pencil guy, I'm a paint guy. I just sort of tried to look at it as, I'm just gonna try to do what's good for this thing, just like what I tried for houses.
Yeah.
How about you? I mean, you started off, you're going to have to correct me on this one, but I think you started off oils, mm-hmm. but then you sort of said, it's not working for me. Then you moved into acrylics?
Yeah, I just
expanded.
I did some covers in wash or watercolor for a while, and then I said, you know what, I think I'll learn acrylics and do it. And that felt like second nature to me. And after working with it for a little while, I found I didn't have to think much about the process of painting, you know, and it became more automatic for me. And to this day, I still have a real lack of comfort factor with oils compared to working in acrylic for some reason. It just, part of it is that I know that there's no mistake so bad in any acrylic painting I've done that I can't repair, so that you can't tell that I made the error. Whereas with oil paints, you know, you have to be very conscious of your layering. That, you know, I get away with not being as accurate a drawer. I hate to admit it, but that with acrylics, and correct mistakes that I've made in anatomy or whatever that I see later down the road. With oils, you know, once they're in there, for me, they're locked in. You know, it's not supposed to be that way. Oils should be loosened. But if the original first layers are off, I think it's hard for me to get over that and fix it. So,
okay, it's a technical one. I got to ask. So, like media for your acrylics. I mean, what kind of mediums do you use with your acrylics when you're
I reinvent my procedure with every painting I'm doing. That's a great way of dodging the question. I refuse to use retarders and things that extend the drying time, because a lot of what my technique's about is having the paint dry fast so I can layer and layer and layer and layer.
Okay.
A lot of paintings in the art show have 30 or more layers of paint on them, but that's I've changed my mind about that,
really?
And I'm using retarders more now. At the last big demo that I was involved with. I tried doing it in acrylics, and I bought a lot of some of those open acrylics that the Golden Paint Company has.
Yeah, yeah.
They're supposedly have a longer wetting or drying time and everything, but the problem is I never get the sense that they actually ever fully dry. one of the pieces I did at the last Illexcon, I put under a faucet before I came here to Boston, and the paint just all washed off. So it's the one that I did the demo on a few hours ago. It's that panel. It originally had a whole different paint on it. And now it's in the same state. So I'm still playing around with using acrylics in a live painting situation. In my studio, I use a lot of the Golden acrylics. The GAC 200 is an acrylic medium that dries to a really hard finish, and you can beat it to death in it. And it never gets sticky, no matter how humid it is. And a lot of the other acrylic mediums and things that you use on a humid day, you put your finger on it and feel how sticky they are. You know, and they can't be good. You know? And so I'm constantly experimenting, but I use a lot of the GAC 200 now.
So. I'm going to jump rather abruptly. I wanted to jump back to deadlines. We were talking about.
Yeah.
We just barely touched on this last time. It's kind of another piece of programming, but. Michael had mentioned that in regards to another artist, a deceased artist, I believe, the notion of deadlines and how they've shrunk from the days when you were working prolifically in the field. Let me just say, ask a specific question, just to give some sort of frame of reference. The Joan Vinci Snow Queen painting, large painting down there in the art show, one of my all-time favorites, by the way.
Yeah.
That piece, how long did you have to do the piece, and then give me a scope of like from it, because you read that book.
I was probably booked up for that.
Since
the late 70s, I've been booked up over a year in advance.
Okay. Got it.
So for the Joan Vinci cover, I probably knew a year ahead of time that I was going to be doing that, or 10 months, max, minimum. But my problem is that I'd always start working on it 3 weeks before it's due. So it might as well have been a short deadline, because by the time I get to it, I've got so many other things in between, and I got a cold, a third of the 12 covers I was going to be doing in the next 12 months, and so maybe late on all the other ones after that, and by the time I got to it, the stack is shortened up, and oh my god, and so it invariably happened that way.
That's that 10 months. That sounds like a never land.
Yeah.
I've never heard of that. I have got two jobs where I had a year to work on it, and one of them I saw with that triptych shadow box that you see down in the art show. That's on the end cap for a Jeff Ward trilogy. That was the solution for that one. It was because I thought that was the right approach for that book, but also I had that long to come up with a solution for that. There's no way I could have done that on a 4-5 week deadline.
Sometimes it's a bad thing to have too much time.
Yes, it is, and I definitely speak to that.
Yeah, I had almost around a year to do the work for the last Gunslinger book.
Oh yeah.
But it was 12 color paintings, including the cover, and I don't know how many black and white paintings and a bunch of pen-to-ink drawings. So it was a lot of work for that one project. But I had a lot of time to do the work in. One of the reasons I haven't done any illustrations for The Lord of the Rings is that when the second time I was offered the series, they wanted all the work for the Hobbit and the Three Rings books in a month and a half. And I said, I'm not going to take that, and fall flat on my face and do a terrible job and ruin my life. I'll wait until you give me enough time to do a good job on it. It never happened. So.
Yeah. Well, I got I approached George R. R. Martin at Worldcon in Montreal and said, hey, if there's ever a point down the road where maybe we could work together. I kind of dig that. And then the next night, in the bar, he walks up to me about...
You have something for me by Monday?
Night, he says, hey, that thing you mentioned last night, were you serious about it? And I said, what thing? About working with you? He said, I was serious. And
awesome.
He says, you ever read my books? And I said, there was a few short stories that I read that really impressed me. And that's what I was referring to. And I said, books or stories? And I said, told the stories I can hear. And he said, no, I mean A Song of Ice and Fire. You know those, don't you? And I said, I know how big they are. And I know I could kill somebody with a hardcover. But I'm not not read it, I gotta admit. And he's like, well, you know, he said, how fast do you read? And I said, what are we talking about? And he says, I've got this calendar. And he says, I've seen your Eldred stuff and I'd love to see you do it. And I said, what's the timeline? He says, I don't know anything about that stuff, but I'm gonna pitch you and if you wanna do it. And so I found out on my birthday, September 3rd, actually, I found out, I got a call from Bantam, and they said, listen, we would really like to, George wants you badly, and we want to see you do it, but here's the deadline. And that was my birthday, September 3rd, and we want 12 finished, full, you know, color painting pieces. Can we get it by February 1st? And I said, well, that would be cool, but got these books that are 1,200 pages each, and I'm going to need to understand that stuff. And they said, well, can you listen? Can you do audiobooks? And I said, well, I've never done that. Can you paint? Can you paint and listen to audiobooks at the same time?
That's really not a bad way to go.
Have you done that?
Oh yeah.
I can't. I couldn't do it. So I just had to bear down and read it. And it's going to be tight. I mean, it's going to. And they actually pushed the deadline because they realized that was just undoable. But I wondered back in the day.
But I was going to say, my answer would have been, are we talking a wall calendar or a desk calendar? Did I correct those? My doors have no problem.
A Dilbert size?
Yeah.
No, I wasn't that smart.
Brasio size.
it's been a definite learning experience, this one. But it's been fun. Look, it's already what do we got?
We got a couple minutes.
Yeah, we got a couple.
This is an old book. This is your, was this the 1991?
1993.
Okay. So I had this on my shelf, but I pulled it out on the plane over here, on the flight over. And of all the things you said, there's this one quote, and I just wanted you to maybe, I'm not going to hold you to this one, because it's 1993, so lots happened since then. But I want you to maybe just kind of tell me what you think about this, especially the last part. Another way to think of my paintings is as dreams, where often it isn't the setting and events that are recalled, but the feeling of mystery and strangeness. Like dreams, my paintings are in the language of personal experience in our real world, but altered. The subconscious mind disassembles experiences and synthesizes meaning and relevance from them, but the source and the new perceptions seem real, so I paint the unreal in a realistic manner. This is the part that grabs me. Of course, the difference between paintings and dreams is that paintings offer a repeatable experience, which is the essence of art. And I thought about that on the whole flight over after reading that. I thought, I think I get what he's saying, but I really need to ask you about that. What do you mean by offer a repeatable? I definitely think I get what you're saying about repeatable experience.
An answer is
that it's the essence of art.
For me, that's an answer. Oh. That what is art? It's offering a repeatable aesthetic experience. You go to a museum and see a beautiful painting of the sunset, that sunset's going to stay there. You know, while you're watching the sunset, in reality, you have the knowledge that it's changing as you're watching it. And 5 minutes later, it's ephemeral, it's gone, you know. And you can choreograph a dance and write sheet music, and that same piece of music can be played for another audience on the other side of the world. They have the sheet music for it, you know, and so it offers an antidote to the negative aspect of the awareness of the passage of time. You know, and Shakespeare said every rose contains within the dying, the bud of dying. Every infant has contains within it the seeds of its own death. You know, nothing lasts forever.
Yeah.
But we can try to lengthen at least the time that we give ourselves to appreciate and experience wonder and beauty by creating works of art that we can surround our lives with and give ourselves time to treasure and appreciate. And that for me makes it all worthwhile. Gives me a reason to do what I do.
It's interesting because it's almost like it's almost an answer, almost like I would say it's almost like the way a journalist would try to lock something down and say this is what happened at this time in this place,
yeah,
and sort of be a reporter. But I don't see you as a guy who's trying to record reality. I mean, I see you more as a vision guy. You've got things you're seeing in your head.
I'm trying to record those.
Yeah,
and where they come from, I can't tell you.
Right.
You know, it's
right.
The weirdest thing, but it happens when I'm asleep. It happens in episodes between dreaming and sleep, And just in my waking life, I could be coming up the escalator, and I have a sense in my mind of my mind operating on more than one track.
Yep.
And I can be talking to you and looking at this audience and thinking of a sunset and seeing that in my head at the same time. And sometimes I'll see something in my mind, a picture that has a special note of significance to it. For some reason, it calls to me and says, I need to be realized or brought in. And I'm here to paint the paintings that Michael Whalen's supposed to paint, you know. And you know, I don't know, some artists have talked about feeling like they're a radio and they're tuned into a certain station, and when the message comes through and they can get it and access it and keep it long enough to get it into a form that other people can see, that's basically what they're here for, you know. I had an assistant who helped me when I broke my hand in my karate class, and I couldn't open up the jars of paint. I needed someone to sit behind me in my studio and open the jars for me. So I had the cast made, so I brought a brush with me to the emergency room so that I could still so I could open the jars up. But he wanted so bad to be a fantasy painter and everything, and all his paintings looked like really bad imitations of my work. And I said, I'm already doing my work. You know, I don't need you to do my work. I need you to do your work. You know, and he was a Vietnam vet. He knows what it's like to wade waist deep in the jungle water and have leeches on him and see what the dappled sunlight coming through the jungle canopy looks like, or what it's like to dare enemy fire. And I said, I can't access it. If I tried to paint that, it would pull me as hell. It might look real to me, but to someone who's actually experienced it, it would be yes, you know. You can access things in your life experience that I can't access. What you're here for is to synthesize what you've been given as experience and perception, and incorporate that into your work and make your work your own.
That's absolutely right.
It doesn't mean you have to do war paintings, but draw on that experience to inform your visual content so that it's yours and nobody else's.
It's the number one thing I tell to guys who are trying to break in or trying to become professionals or just starting out a career, and I always say, you know, I think one of the best things that ever happened to me was realizing that it was going to be very important if I was going to survive in this field to not just be handed ideas and be a guy who was just known for having a great right hand who could execute an idea.
Yeah, a renderer. There's a lot of good renderers. Just like there's a lot of good guitar players.
Absolutely.
There's not a lot of good songwriters.
But it was going to be very important if I was going to make it to be able to be handed something and be able to filter it in a personal way that was true to the story, but that my own way of seeing the world somehow was able to filter out. It can never be overpowering. But it's gotta be in there, or else this thing's not gonna be resonant. And I don't know how to explain it other than that, but I figured that out pretty early. And I've always told guys it has to be there.
Or a lot of people never learn that.
And you're gonna burn out if you don't have that. So I know we gotta wrap up, but I wanna ask you just one last one real quick. You moved on to where you're now doing your own visions and in the gallery. So what was sort of that turning point, if I can ask that? It's kind of maybe a rough one, I don't know. But a turning point where you said, you know what, I think this is a period of my life that I'm ready to close down or wrap up and move toward my own personal works. It was a work called Avatar.
It was a gradual thing. I started doing paintings just to hang in my house. I can't explain why. That was born from an experience I had in an isolation tank, and I was there, you know, and I felt the experience so vividly that I felt it had to be expressed. So I did the big painting. In fact, the people own that in Chicago just emailed us 2 days ago. And now I know who owns it. You know, it got sold by a gallery at the Midwest, and I found out where it went to. So. But anyway.
That was a strange one to try to bring it to a close. We've already got some people tripping
in.
I honestly could keep going here. But thanks for coming out. Really appreciate it. Thank you.